Coming up, we're talking about what now moments that shaped laws, brought smiles, and saved lives.
The Whitney Reynolds Show was made possible by O'Connor Law Firm. When it comes to your injuries, we take it personally. Cyton, because results matter. Children's Learning Place, excellence in early childhood education since 1998. Theraderm Clinical Skincare, committed to developing skincare products designed to restore skin health and promote natural beauty. And by SD Innovations, Hollis CPAs and Associates, Foresighted, UFC Gym Lakeview, Fresh Dental, Kevin Kelly with Jamison Sotheby's International Realty, The Cryo Bar, Barkbusters, and CI Med Spa, and by other sponsors.
What now when your world stops spinning? When you realize life as you know it will never be the same? Today we are taking a look at these moments and seeing how our guest made it through them.
You're watching The Whitney Reynolds Show.
Being awake for your worst nightmare. That's where we begin.
Our first time blueberry picking, Cam, say hi. Cootie, say hi, good job. Cameron, do a good job. Cootie.
9 bullets in her baby's chest. A horrific tragedy for any parent to witness. After being beaten and asked, "Are you ready to die?" Cassandra Tanner Miller's estranged husband ran upstairs to her kids. That's when 1-year-old Colton was shot and killed. Nothing can change the darkness of her loss. However, through her deep grief, she's pushing to ensure that no other parent will need to go through this type of pain.
Well, we all just watched your story, but to have you here with us and to relive this, I know it's going to be tough. So, Cassandra, can you walk us through that day?
So September 21st, 2019, at about 2:15 in the afternoon, I had gotten groceries delivered and I was actually waiting for the groceries to arrive. And my daughter said, "Hey, the Instacart just got here." So I was laying down in bed upstairs in the master bedroom. I had just nursed Colton to sleep. I was sleeping next to him. I just kind of nodded off and Cam goes, "Hey, the groceries just got here." And so I said, "Go down, open the door, bring the groceries in, and as soon as I get him fully to sleep, I'll put them away." And then she comes back up like 10 minutes later and she goes, "I brought them inside, but Mom, I'm hungry. Can you make me something to eat?" And I said, "Sure, hold on 1 second." So I unlatched Colton and I kissed him on his head and I said, "I'll be right back up, Bubba." And I never made it back up. Walked down the stairs, brought in the groceries. I picked them up and carried them from my front door and dropped them into the kitchen, put them onto the counter. Now, the corner of my eye, I'd seen something kind of go past me, a shadow. And I thought to myself, well, maybe it was a hawk. I live kind of back up to a rural corn area. And then I turned around to put the groceries away, and I saw him standing in my sliding glass door. And it was a look I'd never seen before. He was something I had never seen or experienced. And I immediately looked at Cameron, and I said, "Run, go get your brother." And as I said that, the back sliding door ripped open and he stepped in and I pushed Cam back again because she didn't move. And I said, "Run, go get your brother, get out of here." And he said, "Are you all ready to die?" And he ran towards me and started punching me in my face. The first hit that he had delivered towards me, it shattered and blew my eardrum. I dropped onto the ground. He dragged me by my hair, kicking me, punching me, hitting me through my hallway in front of the door and the stairs so they couldn't get out. And Cameron, I know she had told me, I thought if he just kept sleeping and I just watched guard of him, that whatever Chris was doing, he would stop and then he would just leave.
You said in an interview that you met Satan that day.
Yes.
Was it when he opened the door, you knew something was different?
The energy he was giving out, the look in his eyes, it was, I'd never seen something so empty, but so destructive. And he'd said, you're just never going to feel the love of anyone. You're never going to feel anyone else's touch. We're going to die here together. And he said, I just love you so much. I just love you so much. I just want you to know that this is why I'm doing this. And he put both his hands against my throat and he strangled me to the point where he was on top of me pressing down and I stopped moving. My daughter said that I went completely lifeless. I did not move, did not do anything anymore. And then she said he walked over. I had a 4-foot candlestick sitting off to the side and he picked it up. And he flipped me over onto my stomach and he started bashing me in the back of my head and my back with it. And then finally it broke in half and he started kicking me in my ribs and stomping my knees and my legs so I couldn't get back up. And Cameron said I had no more movement and he leaned down.
And your daughter saw this.
She saw all of it because she was standing in the loft looking down and she was trying to find a way that she could get out and bring Colton, but you know, I feel bad because she was just 9. There's no way that she understood what was actually going on. Had anyone ever experienced this? And it's terrifying for her, you know? And so after that, she said he leaned down and like took my pulse. He was a paramedic by trade originally. And she said he stood over her and he said, she's dead. She's done, and looked up. And then as he walked up the stairs, she said he pulled out the gun. And he looked at her and he said, are you having fun yet, Cameron? And he turned into the bedroom where Colton was sleeping and he shot him, the coroner said, at a minimum of 10 times. But because Colt was so little and his skull was so fragile, it was hard for them. But they had 10 traces where they could actually see entrances and exits in my son's 18-month-old skull, you know? And then she said that she was standing in the bathroom and she went to run towards the stairs and he grabbed her after he had shot and killed Colton. And he tried to like lift her up and she didn't know if he was trying to throw over the stairs. So she grabbed onto the railings and he was trying to get her to flip over because he didn't want to look her in the face. And he was loading the gun. He was hitting her in the face with it. And then finally he was biting her. He was biting her body just like he had bit me all over. He was biting her body, trying to get her to stop fighting back.
How did you get that? I gotta mama bear go.
There's only thing that had to be some type of divine intervention that my son or God knew that in that moment that Colton, Cameron was still alive. Colt was gone. And whether they helped me, whether you believe in it, whether you don't, but all I remember is gasping for air, going, and that's all I remember. And she said, I started crawling up the stairs and then he let go of her to continue loading the gun. She said he was picking up bullets off the ground and out of his pockets. And we had a baby gate at the very top of the stairs. And she had told me that she swung her legs under and then she clipped the baby gate because she knew it would slow him down.
Good.
And she said that I started to stand up and I was grabbing her and telling her to run. And I said, I got to get Colton. And she said, Mom, he's got a gun. And she pulled me down to the ground as he started shooting. The bullets were ricocheting. One went across my back. She pulled me down. I tumbled down the stairs. And she said, I fell down to the very bottom of the stair. And she put her arm around me. And we put her arm in. And we got through the front door. And I collapsed. And then my neighbors dragged me to their garage until the ambulance had arrived.
That story for anyone watching right now is unreal.
Yes.
It is so hard to hear. Lived through that. Like you said, there must have been some type of oomph in you that day in survival. And did your estranged husband have PTSD? Was there a mental disorder? What do you think could have led him to that?
Well, he was never deployed, so there's no PTSD. He was serving as a, what they call like an MD soldier, where they just do the Army Reserves, where they just go there once a month, they check in. But he's never been deployed, never saw war. So the PTSD aspect doesn't, it's a lack of accountability his entire life, behaviors and decisions that he did that never, he never faced consequences. And I think the drug use that he had, he was a cocaine addict. I'm sure that accounted to more behavioral issues with him, but deep down inside, there's no excuse or no behavior, no justification. This is something he's always wanted to do. He was a domestic violent abuser. And if they hit you one time and they are able to put danger and instill fear in you and put their hands on you one time, they have by far the capability their entire life to be able to be the one that takes your life from you. And it was just not a matter of if he was going to do it, it was when he was going to do it. And September 21st became that day for my family, unfortunately.
Oh my. So going back to his issues.
Yes.
Did you, obviously you filed with the court that this was happening.
Yes.
How did the system potentially fail you?
Well, I mean, I alerted the Army about his behavior, which was a huge issue because he had self-reported having anger issues, drug issues, and being in legal trouble. So I thought the Army was going to be my first resource because this is a trained soldier. This is somebody that they had signed a contract with. He should be representing them in a proper way. And they ignored every single plea that I did. They stopped taking phone calls. They stopped responding to me. As far as the judicial system, you know, he was facing two counts of aggravated felony for almost 2 years. And they just, it's a slow system that with that ability to give so much spacing in between where they face consequences, it allows them for continued bad behavior and patterns.
Well, let's talk about what you are doing now because you started keeping your son's legacy alive forever through Colton's Law. Let's talk about that.
So Colton's Law, it's a domestic violence task force. That's the first one Illinois has ever had. And it's basically going to relook at the entire state and how we handle domestic violence, what laws, what things that we have. And each district and each county has its own availability of how they handle domestic violence. But that needs to stop because domestic violence needs to have the same consequence and the same consistency of how it's handled throughout the state. So individuals who are abusers know that they can't escape from one place to another and continue their cycle of behavior. And, you know, I knew that when I met David Welter and I put my son's urn on his desk, and this was only about 2 weeks after this happened, I told him if I save one family in my son's honor, then it's worth the pain that I live every single day. And unfortunately, everyone has a story, and this one's just written forever in permanent marker as it seeps through the pages of every other page that's attached to it. But this is just my story, and I don't want it to be anyone else's story. And no one else should hold their son in a funeral home for the last time, touching him, warming his hands, his cold hands, and knowing that they'll never, ever be able to hold their child ever again, you know? And I promised him when I looked down at him that this was going to be my goal. God gave me a second chance, and the tears that I cry every single day for my son, the amount of pain I am, it's a quantifiable measurement that I'm allowed to finally have when people say, you don't know how much you love your child. I do, because my bucket of tears could fill oceans upon oceans for the rest of my life, and my soul is shattered forever. But this isn't going to be what I'm defined as. What I'm going to define myself as is a survivor, being the voice of victims who weren't able to tell their story because they died at the hands of the abuser. They're not forgotten, and I promise that I will be their voice for as long as God lets me have this second voice.
You're so amazing. You're so amazing. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
For coming on.
Thank you so much.
Next up, we Skype with a world-famous pianist that found his callings, yes, I said that plural, in the midst of the struggle. His most recent hardship was the news that he has terminal cancer. Years later, though, he's still living and joins us now with more.
From 6 Emmys to a Grammy nomination, John Tesh has success on his side. But he's also seen his fair share of failures. His What Now moments have created an ever-evolving roadmap full of hills and valleys that have led him to find hope in the struggle.
I signed my professor's name to the drop ad card and dropped the course, and everything was fine, right? Until the university discovered that I had forged the professor's name, they sent a letter to my dad which was really amazing, and said, your son has broken the honor code at NC State. We're giving him an F for the course and suspending him indefinitely. So he calls me in with a Manhattan in his right hand and a cigarette in his left hand and reads the note off his desk and then promptly says, and you're not welcome in this house anymore, Johnny Tesh. And so he kicked me out of the house. The university kicked me out. My girlfriend broke up with me. I didn't have any place to go. So I got in a Volkswagen and took a pup tent and drove to a park. And I was homeless for 6 months in the park. So within 36 months, I was anchoring the news at WCBS-TV in New York as the youngest correspondent at CBS in 1976. And the story of how I got out of that tent was a sort of one of desperation. But that was probably the lowest moment of my life.
But his journey didn't stop there.
And it happened to me right after I did the Red Rocks special. Nobody would take me seriously as a musician. And my wife and I bet the house on an opportunity to go and play Red Rocks and then just have PBS take a look at it. Well, a nice little old lady in Maryland Public Television, she played it at midnight on a Sunday night when nobody else would touch it because I was the host of Entertainment Tonight reading the celebrity birthdays. It blew up. It raised $10 million for public television, sold 8 million records for me, and I was able to leave television forever.
Now with two successful careers and a beautiful family, the news he was about to receive would stop anyone in their tracks.
Life was perfect for me. I had a couple of grandkids, was married for 24 years. We had a radio show that was thriving on 300 stations. I had sold 8 million records and things had just gone really well for me in my life. And I just went for a normal checkup, and went in there. And when I came out, I had 18 months to 2 years to live. I couldn't get rid of the cancer. It was relentless.
Relentless, the title of his new book, is a memoir of this journey John calls life. And with every twist and turn on his road, he's found hope and even healing through faith.
We actually stood on a scripture, which is on my arm right here. It's called Mark 11:23. And it's about speaking life over yourself with faith-filled words. And the scripture is, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will be done, shall have what he says. And at the moment we got the revelation for that, there was no radiation, there was no more cancer, and we believed it. And 2 years later, we went back in and got a blood test. There were no blood markers.
He's not only speaking life, but also living life.
Our next guest is known as a secret angel. This miracle maker steps in when tragedy strikes, helping people develop their what now. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
Today we've been talking about what now, and really when we hit that bump in the road, how do we move forward? And you are helping people get past that bump. You are actually known, now we have like a celebrity here. You are known as Chicago's secret angel.
Yes, yes, yes.
How did you get that title?
So I was pretty much deemed Chicago's secret angel because of some of the philanthropy work that I do throughout the community. Some of it is known, some of it isn't.
And hint the secret.
Yeah, there you go. There you go. And so pretty much I was given the name Chicago's secret angel.
So tell me about growing up in Chicago and why you chose your home city to do the work in.
So I'm a product of Chicago, west side of Chicago to be exact, which was a pretty rough area even still to this day. I had some friends that I've lost, due to gun violence. There's a lot of things that I couldn't do, as a child. Simple things that literally, you would take for granted, such as going outside, being able to ride your bike, staying out when it's dark, so it was pretty rough, So I always said and vowed that if I were able to get to a point where I was able to work, to help some of these kids that went through the same things as me, that I would.
That's amazing. So let's talk about some of the stuff you've done. One story specifically caught my eye, but I want you to tell it.
So you must be talking about my Christmas giveaways.
Yes.
So every year we do a Christmas giveaway. We go to social media looking for families that have recently lost significant others to gun violence, whether it be parents that have lost their kids to gun violence, or more importantly, kids that have lost parents to gun violence.
Wow. So some kids have lost both parents to gun violence.
Yes. Yes.
How many requests do you get?
We usually get hundreds.
That is crazy to think.
Yeah. Yeah. So we try to select them based off of how soon they've lost them. So usually we try to go most current because we feel like, you know, if this is their first Christmas without their parents, it's got to be tough.
So tender.
Yeah. So I called a couple of my friends. They were, of course, joyfully to get involved. They were like, absolutely, let's find them something, whatever you need. So we partnered, we teamed up together, and we were able to find them a location. And I was so happy because I wanted to do this before the new year. And that was significant to me because they had lost their mom the year prior. So literally their whole lives had changed. They lost their mom, no place to stay. And these are the types of things that I try to get people to see. These are the after effects of gun violence, which are sad. I mean, literally, you know, these kids had got displaced from their schools. They had to leave schools because they, one, were scared to stay in the same neighborhood.
Right.
And two, they couldn't afford to stay in the same neighborhood. So they had to literally bounce around. So my mission was, and this, keep in mind, Christmas is on the 25th. My mission was to get them in a house before the new year. So that was literally, what, a week away?
Yeah.
So literally, I got on the phone, spoke to a couple of my business friends, Pam and Spencer. Phenomenal, phenomenal, phenomenal. And they literally said, hey, let's make it happen. So we were able to locate them a house. And it was completely renovated. I mean, everything was gorgeous. Everything was new. And I was like, yes. You know, and it was funny because I thought I was going to have an issue with finding them something because, one, I was putting my name on it, but I wasn't the one moving in. So a lot of the people that we were calling were like, no, if you're not moving in it, no. You know what I mean? We don't know who these kids are, you know, whatever the case is. So a lot of people didn't want a 19-year-old with her siblings, even though she's old enough, didn't want, you know, so that was the hard part. So, but I was able to luckily convince some realtors to agree to it. I told them the story and they were like, let's do it, you know? So I was ecstatic. I was like, yes, okay, cool. And it was literally like, I had 2 days left.
2 days to spare. Yeah. The secret angel strikes. And you gave it to him rent-free for a year.
Yes.
And there was a cherry on top as well.
The cherry on top was I found out that her vehicle that she had, which was her mom's, the engine had went out. So I said, gosh, okay.
Here you go again.
Yeah, so we were able to give her our vehicle as well. And they were ecstatic. And it was literally like tears of joy from her and her brother. And I was like, I did it.
You did it.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for having the heart you do, the courageous spirit to get people from their what now to what next. Thank you so much, Early.
Thanks for having me.
We wanted to leave you inspired and to know that life is full of what's. And our next interview is a reminder that innocence and childlike faith is a true gift.
What may seem like a lighthearted movie is rooted with pushing on despite your what now? Or in Troop Zero's case, your what no?
Want to be Birdie Scout? Want to go to Jamboree?
Jamboree is a talent show? Is that you? Or is trash you?
So it's about this little girl named Christmas Flint. She's weirder than everybody else and everybody's bullying her. But then when I read the script, I was like, this is a good movie. And the message is like, it doesn't matter if you're weird because there's we're all weird in our own way. So you can always find your own truth.
It was a rejection or no that could have stopped some in their tracks. But for this troupe, it was the start of a blooming friendship and ultimately a happy ending.
No, the only number left in the state of Georgia is zero.
So
welcome, Troop Zero.
This is what God gave me to work with, and I'm going to make it beautiful because it's mine.
Well, we look forward to seeing what you little girls are making.
So then she gathers a troop, and then in the process, they end up being friends.
Kids can be the best reminder that dreams really do come true. If we push past the no and believe in ourselves, then we might just watch them grow.
I think you'd like me. I think you'd want to be my friend.
What now when life gets tough and it's hard to push on? Keep going. Keep going because someone needs you to. Remember, your story matters.
The Whitney Reynolds Show was made possible by O'Connor Law Firm. When it comes to your injuries, we take it personally. Cyton, because results matter. Children's Learning Place, excellence in early childhood education since 1998. Theraderm Clinical Skincare, committed to developing skincare products designed to restore skin health and promote natural beauty. And by SD Innovations, Hollis CPAs and Associates, Foresighted, UFC Gym Lakeview, Fresh Dental, Kevin Kelly with Jameson Sotheby's International Realty, The Cryo Bar, Barkbusters, and CI Med Spa, and by other sponsors. Go beyond the interview with Whitney Reynolds and her 52-week guide of inspiration. The book goes deeper into the topics you see on The Whitney Reynolds Show. To get your copy for $12.95 plus shipping and handling, go to whitneyreynolds.com/store and use code PBS. For more information on today's program, visit whitneyreynolds.com or follow us on social media on Twitter at Whitney Reynolds and on Instagram at Whitney_Reynolds.
Or